Good. What are you doing?
This table feels different. Dude, this chair is different. Your chair is different. This wall is different. Something changed.
It's budget cuts. You didn't hear?
What?
The producer has been cutting funding to this show. Like, next year, this show might not even exist. They may replace us with some AI or something.
But we've been getting better every episode.
I don't know.
What's up, everyone? In case you haven't watched the other episodes, my name is Indra.
I'm Wesley.
And welcome to our show, What's Up? You get the bag and fumble it. You get the bag and fumble it. You get the bag and fumble it. I get the bag and flip it and tumble it. Straight off the line. Today, we're going to talk about artificial intelligence. And when I talk about artificial intelligence, I don't necessarily mean the super intelligence that's going to take over the world and kill everyone.
By definition, AI is a field of computer science dedicated to solving cognitive problems that are usually solved with human intelligence, such as learning, pattern recognition, and other types of problem solving. Basically, anything that a human would need intelligence to do.
And there's two types of AI, narrow AI and general AI. Narrow AI is an intelligence system that's been taught or learned how to do tasks without exactly knowing how to do them at first. A simple example would be like when you go on Amazon and the website suggests new products for you to buy based on your purchase history. Narrow AI can only do certain tasks, as their name. When companies today say that they're using AI to do something, this is pretty much the kind of AI they're talking about. General AI is a type of intelligence system that can carry out a variety of different tasks, not just the one that a narrow AI has been assigned. It's kind of like the flexible intelligence of a human, almost. This is the kind of AI that's referenced a lot in pop culture, like The Matrix or Ultron. And it doesn't exist today, but a lot of people are debating as to when the first one will be created.
AI works by learning how things work from large sets of data. An AI will process as much data as it possibly can, and it will generate outcomes based on that data. And from that, the AI can form its own algorithms and make decisions faster, repeating the process over and over, and getting more intelligent.
That makes sense in theory, but let's make sure we understand what this looks like in practice. To explain this better, we set up an interview with Tessica Fitzgerald. She's a computer science PhD candidate in the School of Interactive Computing at Georgia Tech and a researcher in human-robot interaction and cognitive systems.
My research is related to robots that learn from interacting with people. So if we expect robots to be fairly commonplace in the future, being helpful around the home, in hospitals, in schools, outside, and so on, robots need to be able to learn quickly. We can't expect that all these robots are just going to know everything out of the box. So in order to get robots to learn on the fly, we want to be able to take advantage of how humans learn from each other and implement something similar in robots so that a robot can ask questions or ask for help or otherwise interact with people in order to learn something new.
How does this type of learning work? What are some of the specific things that, I guess they would ask questions, but like what are some other things that they do?
Asking questions is what we call active learning. So that relates to the robot having to compute something about the knowledge that it has and the knowledge that it needs, which is something that, of course, you and I do very easily on a regular basis. But for a robot, knowing the context around certain questions, knowing what questions it can ask, what is the kind of information it'll get from different questions and so on, is a lot more complicated. So a lot of active learning has to do with evaluating different things that the robot can ask and how helpful it is to the robot. Another type of learning that we do is learning from demonstration, which is where instead of programming a robot to do something, we'd actually interact with it physically. So instead of programming a robot how to pick up a cup and move it, we would actually pick up the robot's hand and guide it through those actions.
It's important to understand artificial intelligence and what it does because it's such an integral part of our daily lives. Today, people are using AI to spot potential tumors in x-rays, flag and report inappropriate content online, analyze video feeds of roads and bridges to look for damage and flaws, and so much more. Its capabilities are only going to increase, and we can't be ignorant. It's like trying to ignore the internet.
To understand more about the purpose and use of AI in business and society as a whole, we recently set up an interview with Robert Bates, a research scientist in the Design Intelligence Lab at Georgia Tech.
We primarily work with cognitive and knowledge-based AI systems and solutions built around those systems.
Why is AI important? Like, why do we need computer intelligence? What's the big deal here?
Well, I think if we can get the bias issues addressed correctly within research, I think artificial intelligence can provide a more objective way of solving some common problems more quickly and more accurately. I think it can help benefit society, it can benefit economies, it can benefit production. Because right now there's just a lot of data and information and educational material being generated, but it's not always accessible and not very usable a lot of times. And AI kind of helps make that more accessible.
I can see why AI would be useful in helping people be more productive and advance society, but there's a lot of worry about AI right now too, with it replacing people's jobs, becoming dangerous, and taking over the world.
Based on a lot of what we hear and see in the news, it could seem like that. But we wanted to get the perspective of someone who's been in the space a bit longer than just us. So we interviewed Igor Japlikov, the CEO and founder of Prion, a stealth AI startup, and the man behind the teams that designed IBM's Watson and Amazon's Alexa.
Everyone's afraid of this like AI super intelligence. We were at South by Southwest when Elon was saying like that's the number one thing that he's worried about in the future of like, the world. And so how big is this threat really? And you know, kind of like what is your take on it?
I think it's silly. I mean, it makes for great headlines, of course, but it's as silly as being afraid of your own children, right? If you're not giving them proper, you know, nature, nurture, you know, giving them proper input, guidance, curtailing, you know, negative impulses and things of that sort, then you have every right to be afraid of the outcome. You know, I typically joke and jest that if you look at Charlottesville or whatever those riots were happening, you know, I didn't see Siri punching Alexa's nose. It was humans causing problems for each other. And so we're kind of the source of the Nile for a lot of BS. And yet we're trying to, almost pass responsibility to some random objective machine that's coming to harm us as if we've, you know, acted like daffodils towards each other.
So AI may not be elected supreme overlord of the world anytime soon. That being said, we need to be very careful in how we proceed in developing it in the future. We need to be more thoughtful in just how we develop AI today. Who's designing it, how people perceive its manifestations, what data it uses, and where we implement it. Aside from that, we need to make sure that the teams who are building AI are very diverse and inclusive. Remember way back when facial recognition would only work with people with lighter skin? That's not the fault of the technology, that's more the fault of the teams that were comprised to build that technology. If the teams were as diverse as the population that they're meant to serve, then that wouldn't have been a problem at all.
A lot of people assume that AI, since it's not human, is inherently unbiased and objective. In reality, AI is only as unbiased as the data we feed it and the way we design it.
Let's let Robert from Georgia Tech shed some light on this topic.
It's a big issue because you have the way a lot of artificial intelligence systems are constructed is using data sets. And these data sets are collected from different groups, different organizations, different data sources. Sometimes those data sources have an explicit bias. Like if you did a survey of college students, you're going to be biased towards people in the early 20s. Most of your psych experiments are biased towards college-age students, for example. And then you get some that are just unintentional biases due to, just demographics of who was surveyed or who was participated in the data collection. So, and there are a lot of organizations working to try and address that right now, but it is definitely something that's kind of a hot topic at the moment for obvious reasons. And the AI community and machine learning community both are very keen on trying to address it and at the very least, identify when a bias does exist so they can counter it and find better ways to remove it from the systems themselves.
You know, negative worries about AI aside, I'm pretty excited for the future. There's so many ways that we can use AI to benefit society and even improve ourselves.
Like, what do you mean about improve ourselves? Like cyborgs and stuff?
I'll let Igor from Prion explain that.
A lot of people are afraid of these AIs replacing people and work and jobs and things of that sort. And that's a little bit silly because we think that it's more the age of augmented intelligence that's coming. Because if you look at, what we learned with some of our staff members working on the Jeopardy, supercomputer known as Watson, human reasoning is just under 70%. Machine recall is just over 70%. But when you actually put a human and machine working together towards accomplishing a certain task, you end up getting near 100% accuracy within a couple turns. If you take the sum total of every dollar that was ever spent on technology everywhere, right? So think of databases and cybersecurity tools and applications and devices and servers and cloud, everything, right? If you take all of that money and put it together, right, and put all of those systems there, they only represent 1% of knowledge that's required to run a given organization. The other 99% is trapped in human minds. Literally, humans are a critical part of every workflow out there.
We covered a lot of information about AI today. Now that you're more informed, here's a couple things you should do after this episode. First, if you're interested, definitely read up more about artificial intelligence. There's a ton of content online about it, from research in the field to current ways it's being implemented around the world. It's just fascinating stuff.
Second, if you're genuinely worried about AI replacing your job in the future, you may want to take a hard look at the skills that you have and what value you can offer to the world. Try picking up some new skills, whether it's learning a new software language or a vocational skill like becoming an electrician. If you're worried about being replaced, make it harder for them to replace you.
And lastly, check out other episodes of our show, What's Up, for more interesting news, events, technology, and trends around TechSquare, Atlanta, and beyond.